Bears are opening up.
When I got in that, everybody knows our whole routine. I was really sad. Because I had so much anger and so much everything that wasn't good was up inside me that I just acted out. And I went to super fast forward motion in my brain, and all I could think about was being a super GI, being a super soldier, working on a plane, getting in a flying combat performance to go in the air to that plane. You're the ones taking the plane, and of course there was no airplane on the side, but we're doing that just to make sure that we're safe. And every major city is not doing that it's safe to have that plane. But again, I was so dedicated to the cause and so thrown into being what I was doing that it cost me my secretary. It cost me a relationship with you and the book. I have three kids back for my secretary. It cost me my relationship with him. But I could not be a good father. I couldn't be a good husband. I could only be a soldier. Finally, about 2005, things were so messed up in my head. I started showing up to work late. I went from being high on the court pole, on my character integrity, where I came into work and I started getting lectured. I started getting ripped up. Finally, they said, okay, stop. Enough is enough. And I got forced out. I forced out of the military, 2005. My father, my hero, 2005 was the year I got divorced. So I basically lost a military career, lost a marriage, lost a father. Now I'm being forced out into the world as to what I was going to do. They really set the wheel forward of me sitting out of control. I went for 9 years bouncing from job to job to job to job. I couldn't handle the stress that was there. The only way I could learn how to deal with things was to bridge the gap. I was drinking anywhere from 30 to 45 beers a night. I was there at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and I wouldn't stop until after the time where I would always say to them, that way I would have that next one going on, the one that I have. Again, I started making a lot of bad choices. Those bad choices, as you can imagine, ended up getting me in trouble with the law where I ended up in jail. And there was my family. Only imagine what the kids saw me. So everybody disassociates themselves with me. So again, it was my character integrity to be that guy that wasn't one of the hero. Finally, October 26, 2014, after I got out of jail, I decided I had enough. And I tried to take my own life. I would say though, thank God I joined the Air Force, I believe. If I'm not, I'm not going to go up there. And I hit the ground and hit the ground hard. Remember though, at that point, I had a sense of calm and peace came over me. And remember, it's not going to get any worse than this. Nothing is going to get worse than this. It's only going to get better. And it was from there, the cops came in, because I'd already called 911 and told them where they could find me. They got me up off the ground, ended up going to the hospital about a week, to go connect. And they ended up sending me down to Brattleboro, Vermont. They were at Brattleboro. I spent a week in the psych center, and then we moved to the uniform services program. The uniform services program is a program where they treat people with PTSD and go with addiction issues. And it was there that I was finally diagnosed with PTSD. And it was there that I met a lady at the time, and not Bethany Perry, Bethany had with me. And every time I went in and talked to Bethany, she was going to counsel there. She noticed that I was opening up a little bit more and more. And I would talk through it, and I would sit and talk to it for penny weight at the top, more and more and more and more. And that decision was finally made to introduce me to the service thought process. So very fresh in my recovery, they took me for a week, and they brought me here, where I got to meet Carlene for the first time. I met Oliver, I believe, at Oliver, one of the first officers, and I sat on the lap. I thought that was pretty cool. But it was there that the process started getting going for me as to applying for a job to see if possibly it was a job. But I never told Carlene exactly what was going on with me. So I went back after our brief meeting, it was on Sunday, I went back to Brattleboro, finished getting you love bullying, and then move back to Tahoe. Came back here a couple times, and that's when we were going to visit while I was here. And again, I never told Carly exactly what was going on. She had only a vague idea as to what I was all about. But this one specific day that really came to me, I came in and I was like, "Is Diego or Diego?" Diego. I was looking at Diego Kennel. And Tracy called, I thought I'd ask him. She said, "Stop. Why don't you come over?" First of all, I met Emma. I met Emma for a long time. And I remember Emma and I looked at each other, and Emma did not like me. Actually, a lot of dogs didn't like me because I was so stressed out. They were picking up on my stress and they didn't want to get around me. And Emma specifically looked at me, and I looked at him, and he barked at me, and scared the hell out of me. And I'm like, "This ain't going to work. I'm not going to get a dog. I just can't handle it." But Tracy asked me to go off into the legal town, and it was there. She said, "I want to talk to Dad." Because Dash is definitely afraid of men. And I'm thinking to myself, that's kind of a coincidence because I don't like men either. So I remember talking to Tracy and wondering if Dash came up to me like in town on the far end. I opened up the gate, I put the biscuit, I put it up against the floor on the floor. And I went back in the couch at the time. So I sat on the couch, Tracy was sitting there on the counter, we were talking, I opened up the gate to tell him. And I look, and there's no cash. Dad, you got that business again. Got up on the couch next to him. And there I'm at. The couch was there. Well, there's about a minute. But yet she's dealing with the fact that here's a guy who just attempted suicide not too long ago. Here's a guy who's been in jail. Here's a guy who's got obviously had a huge cancer problem. But yet, here's a guy that her doctor chose. So Carly and Mary went out on a limb for me. But she says, "Who am I to judge my dog? If my dog chose you, then my dog chose you in the world." But I had to give her a lot of guarantees. I had to check in very often. I spent a week or so here, and then I got her. She sent me on my way. I was pretty much calling her every other day or whatever. But she made sure I came back in a couple months. I mean, at the time, she was thinking about shipping back, putting a ship there. I guess I thought that was my brother or something. I don't know. That wasn't going to happen. But anyway, so I took that. And I went back to the hospital. And remember the one word, the credit words that really stuck in my mind that Carly told me was, "Stop, I want you to take that, do something with me. Do something with me." And that stuck with me. And it's still to this day. calls, we're looking at the phone, where's the Clinton County jail phone number? I think they wanted that. But if they find out that they're in the phone, she could tell I got that everything. She knows I post a lot of positive things on Facebook, but she posts a lot of negative stuff, but all these years I'm struggling in the world. To me, sorry, she posts a lot of positive things. But she said, she actually had to go in, the pop was better, and I didn't know that that was going to be, that there is hope. So I went in the pop, sheriff, the sheriff was there, the inspector office, and the police were there. In the pop, and he cried, I cried, the sheriff had to cry, but everybody would have to cry. And everybody had to cry, and I got to do that, so it was a push. And he reached out to New York City, kind of threw a bunch of stuff. They had it called trauma program. That's a gay ass, a bunch of trauma programs, but law enforcement first responders, veterans, a lot of social workers. We have to deal with this condition. We travel around talking to people, they go to seminars, and we tell them our story. So they asked me to join the program, and I did. And I started talking about 2 years ago. So the state, I probably got to take 36. But then, that really set forth with me and my position to what I did. I actually felt that, taking that message early, and that was exactly what I was doing. And I could sort of feel like our little challenge. That's exactly what I was doing. That opened up the door for a lot of other things as well. Sign on to the police academy, but then when I get back to Buffalo State, I talk about it. And a couple national organizations that I work in, I have to try to learn something to say to them as well. But again, I'm very humbled by everything that happened in this country. Because as everybody knows, in recipients who have their dogs tend to give us our voice. Our dogs are very liberating to us. They give us the freedom. But just because they're scars, they're not visible from the outside. Inside, I was burying myself. Some people say I'm killing myself. But I'm healing. I'm healing it day by day. My mobility issue at the time, we had to have that. So it's a gift. So with the help of Dad, back in 2015, or 2016, I believe, I didn't have to need a walker, I didn't have to truck, I didn't have to need that. 2 weeks after my surgery, I was able to walk with a hand. I know that PTSD is not a training factor that we use here, but our dogs are so well trained that they just get the wounds. And they do take care of PTSD. That's really been something we have set up for the great country lives. Today I've been in the home show all day, at the race of life, currently trying to take the old fly home. I do plan, it's already told, that I will be getting a date tonight. I will put it on the wall. But anyway, I really want to thank each and every one of you for coming with me. Because these dogs do take care of us. It's definitely a fashion question. I'm going to close out the third of this poem yesterday. When I got Dash, somebody at one of the CPs that sent me a poem, and it's called a Dash poem. And of course, I finally think that they wrote a poem about the dog. Not the kids. Dash poem is all about your ex-husband. The baby of Dash. It's usually read at funeral, memorial, whatever. But I use it, you know, every day. Because it's really an amazing poem. 13 days of the book of following the afternoon. But he said what matters most of all was the last 2 years. For the back represents all time, which is set for all time. And now only those who love her know what that whole life is doing. For it matters not how much we love the parents that have in the past. What matters is how we really love and how we spend our past. So think about the glowing heart or the things you'd like to create. For you never know how much time is left. It could still be your dream. If you just slow down enough to consider it truly real, and always try to understand the way that helps you to feel. If you ask for the anger, you show appreciation more, and help the people in your life that you've never loved before. If you treat each other with respect and go off with a smile, you never met the special guest that's going to go off. So when you do it, you pay your way. With the life actions that you have. You can cut up the things you say about how you say to Dash. That is really powerful. I think it would be a good one. Thank you. Do you have any other questions? Thank you, and I think Charlie had a few things you wanted to say.
Thanks, Scott. Great job.
Hello! I had a bow out earlier. You missed it.
I know.
butterscotch.
She's so cute.
She's so cute.
My butterscotch. Hi, sweetheart.
She is adorable. I want to put her in my car.
I know, huh?
Hi, butterscotch. Grab your back tire because you're dragging. Hey, sweetie. You gotta hurry up and have that baby. What's the baby supposed to
we
do?
We don't know because she's a rescue. So we don't know.
But you just know the
people that felt it kicking around.
Yeah, every once in a while you could see it moving.
You could have had that baby.
Yeah. I keep looking.
Oh, she's been in there.
Month and a half?
Maybe.
Month and a half?
Maybe, yeah. At least a month. You get such short legs. I love it. I love it.
Oh, that little one's going to be cute. Don't you just know it, huh?
Oh, it's going to be adorable.
Want to go venture?
Huh?
Want to go venture and see what they got for food?
You can wander that way.
I think all the dogs are outside. Yeah,
oh, yeah. Dogs are everywhere. Doggies, dogs. You name it.
Oh, yeah.
Watching her for a while yesterday, and I think I did see some movement,
like,
but it's
hard to tell.
It's really,
is it a hiccup, gas,
or is it just her breathing? Because
yeah,
the breathing,
is breathing. Oh, look what you got there.
Is to cut the skin with
a
nail,
and then go in it.
Then it breaks.
Butterscotch, are you getting your treats?
Yeah, that's a good girl.
Life is good, Butterscotch.
She's actually.
She'd have an audience, that's for sure.
She's actually being a little bit more. Hello, Scutterbotch. Coming over at least two.
She really wanted a treat from me earlier. I'm like, I don't have any. It's all over the hands.
sweetie. Oh.
Yeah,
you can make that baby pretty soon.
You just don't realize how I'm
going to play in the
morning.
Not that I can do anything else.
Bye, Mama.
I don't have tweets, I'm sorry. I know you want treats and I don't have them. I'm sorry.
Alright, come on, let's go find it. Because I know he will be happy to have you back. And then I'll bring Asher up.
Dogs they choose to breed.
Oh, I see.
Then what the trainers do. The trainers just.
Yeah, they train them here, right?
Yes, not from the time they first able, you know, to be hand fed. The training begins.
She needs you.
Here. What are you doing, little pony? Hi. Hi, little pony. Hello. Nothing like it. Hey, baby.
Butterscotch.
Butterscotch? Look at you.
She's still not. She'll let some people, some of the staff touch her. She's still.
Okay. She a rescue?
Yeah, they all are. They're all rescues from Kansas, except Poppy and Pockets were born here. Mother's a rescue. She's pregnant. We're not sure when.
My daughter, we rescued two or three from kill pens in Kansas City, and one of them is much smaller than this one, and we had no idea she was pregnant.
Yeah, there's three new out the back barn that just came in yesterday from Texas.
Now, is that the closest?
Texas and Louisiana, yeah. I think, is where Janine, Carlene's daughter, runs Equine Rescue Network.
Oh, okay.
So a lot of times there's two out in the herd.
Oh, okay.
I call them the twins. They're named Bob and Ziggy.
Oh, okay.
That are just here to be socialized.
Oh, okay. And this one here has only been here a little bit.
This is a nursery cam here, live cam.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
And she's here to be watched until she falls.
Okay.
And then I think she already has a home found.
Oh, good. Awesome. Awesome.
She will come to the gate to take a treat from some people.
Hey, baby. Hi, baby. Come over here. Can I say hi?
She's a pretty little thing.
Pony as a baby. Are you preggo? little lady.
Dogs, these big dogs. That's
your size.
I
But Harley has a gash under her chin, but it looks okay. But if you go look at the new donkey, there's a big gash on the face that wasn't there yesterday, and I'm like, it's either, I don't know if it's a gash or it, because it's not bleeding or it's maybe like a tumor.
Yeah. you feeling?
Good, thank you.
Are you?
Yeah. I got to see George. Yeah, he remembers me.
Well, hello.
Hi.
Oh,
making that speech, you said?
Making
taking offense.
Awesome.
Well, and this person don't want to know I'm the one.
Yeah, I already started the grill, then I got sidetracked to go move my car.
Hey, Butterscotch, we didn't have a baby this year.
Yeah. I think that's fine.
Squatch.